Well, this morning let's continue our teachings on struggle and your enemy. Struggle and your enemy. We've been looking at four important forces that literally shorten our season of struggle. The first force I told you was speaking words of faith. Words that build you up, not tear you down. Number two, we saw singing. Whether it's in the spirit or in ministry unto God. Creates a climate that Satan cannot tolerate. He hates people who sing. He hates people who worship God. In fact, he'll do everything in his power to keep you from singing the praises of God on any given day. But you must understand that for you to respond to God rather than to feelings, must so order the pattern of your life and lifestyle that you become a praiser and a worshiper. Remember what the Lord told us when we started off the year 2007. He said, praise and worship will be enhanced. There will be a new anointing when people begin to worship the Lord. He begins to instruct us in song in the stillness of the night, like we read in the Bible. People are increasingly getting up in the morning with praise and worship on their hearts and on their lips. And it's transforming their lives and changing their lives. They are no longer the same after a day of worship and praise. Will there be any less problems in a man's life who's a praiser and a worshiper? No. The clearest example we have of a worshiper is Jesus himself. The Bible says he sang the halal just before he entered into the Garden of Gethsemane, where he would sweat blood because of the immense pressure that was being put on him. So if you think it's going to be easy for a praiser and a worshiper, think again. But in the midst of everything, you can still be a worshiper. You can still be a praiser. Can I have an amen from this church, please? Number three, sharing. Whether it's with an intercessor or with a mentor, you share with someone who will be less judgmental and more supportive. And then finally, seed sowing. Now we've been looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verses 6 to 11 for the last 2 weeks. The reason we are going back to that scripture portion is because your seed sowing creates a partnership with God that involves Him in your adversity. Can I have an amen, please? It is God who ministers seed to the sower, who will minister bread for your food. Now this is what we looked at last week. If it's for personal consumption, the scripture calls it food. Bread. But the moment it leaves your hand for someone else, the scripture calls your money seed. Can I have an amen, please? Seed. And how does it go out of your hand and turn into. It is converted from seed stage to fruit stage. And remember what I told you. Seed is multiplied, never added. And last week when we were here, the Lord spoke a word to my spirit. And someone was here in the service who said, I went through different combinations of what you said in my mind. Everything amounts to only one thing. Increase in a manifold way. Remember, it is seed, time, harvest. The Lord went one step further, put something into my spirit that I shared with you last week. In connection with verse 10 and the word multiply, you use the word times when you speak about multiplication. You never use the word times for addition or for subtraction or even for division. But when you're talking about multiplying something, you say 3 times 3 is 9. 4 times 4 is 16. So what you convert in Genesis that you read about seed, time and harvest is seed multiplied comes back as harvest. And that's what Paul by the Spirit of God is showing us here in 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 10. I told you your seed will see you through your adversity. Your seed will see you through tough times. In fact, when you're going through times that are confusing, the best way to come out of a confusion scenario is to sow the right kind of seeds. Remember the seed that Noah sowed, saw him through his time of adversity. For many years he preached. The preaching that he did was seed he was sowing. No one responded. But animals did. His family did. He did. What happened was his ark did not sink, it floated. That's a miracle. Now look at verse 11. As a result of seed sowing, the Bible says, being enriched in everything to all bountifulness. Can I have an amen, please? Being enriched in everything. Highlight this scripture, please. God wants you enriched in everything. Whether it's for spirit or for soul or for body. We do not serve a God of poverty. We serve a rich God who's actually, according to the Bible, plousios in mercy. Filthy rich in mercy. That's the Greek word. You get the word plutocrat in English from that word, plousios. He is filthy rich in blood mercies. How does God prosper his children? In everything. He makes them rich. To all bountifulness. That means you have enough and more. It's wrong for you to pray, just give me enough for me. It's a sin. I'm again repeating. It's a sin if you make that your prayer. Just give me enough, Lord, for me and my family. That's enough for me. No, you have enough and more to give out to people who don't have. The kingdom of God is a place of great bountiful supply. If you read yesterday's newspaper, you'll read about the Indian billionaires who have started topping the list. Isn't it amazing that the world's richest real estate owner, business magnate, is an Indian? If that is the case, and Indians have started in the secular world becoming billionaires, then it will not be an impossibility for a Christian man to become a millionaire now. And if they become trillionaires, then we will become billionaires as well. And sooner or later, we will overtake them. Can I have an amen, please? I am not joking. You don't know what's happening in this world. Do you know how many times people who are looking at things that they never thought possible are turning around and saying, Pastor, why on earth are they saying there's no money in India? I said, I don't know. Because people think India is a poor country. It's not a poor country. Can I have an amen, please? It is not a poor country. This land is rich in every way. Because the Bible tells me when God created everything, He looked at India and said, very good. In Genesis chapter 1. Can I have an amen? He said, very good. Look at verse 11. Which causeth us thanksgiving to God. Through us, thanksgiving goes to God. Why? Because the saints are enriched in everything. So people in ministry begin to rejoice. The body of Christ begins to rejoice. Not become sour-faced. Not become green-eyed with jealousy. Not go around saying, I don't know how he made his money. Shut up. Just shut up. If you don't know how to make money, then go before God in prayer and ask Him. Because the Bible tells us, God is the one who teaches us how to acquire wealth. If you don't know, go before God. 4 days ago, I received a phone from a man who had come here to meet me, who's heading a ministry in UK. And I was seated with him in this room. I was talking to him. And as I started speaking to him, I told him something. He said, I don't know what to do when I get back. There's so many things that are on. I said, I'll tell you something. Have a paper and pen with you. He looked at me, paper and pen, Pastor? I said, yes, paper and pen. Because even before you land in London, while you are on the flight, God will give you a word. He said, I sense an anointing when you're saying this. I said, I am anointed. I said, I am anointed. So he traveled back to the UK. 4 days ago in the night, I got a call. He was all excited. I said, tell me what happened. He said, this is how he calls me, Reverend, I want to tell you something. While I was on the flight, I got a word from the Lord. And he mentioned the name of someone. He said, I received this word and I wrote it down. And I didn't know what the Lord was telling me. So I landed. And when I was going back to my room, the Lord reminded me of a woman who was the wife of a pastor. And I'd been to that church earlier, a couple of months ago, to preach. And the Spirit of God reminded me and said, go back and meet the lady. So I went there. And she's pastoring along with her husband. And when I met her, immediately there was an unction that was present, and I began to sense that she started loving me as a son. But most importantly, I told her what you said. And she said that she worked with Bishop Coker. Do you know Bishop Coker? I said, yes, I know Bishop Coker. He's gone to be with the Lord, but he used to give me his room key to stay in when I was in Bible college. He said, the world is such a small place, Reverend. Now I have direction and I know what to do. And I was prophesying to him that night on the phone, because as he kept speaking, there was an unction coming on the two of us. And I'm telling you this because you've got to understand, seed sowing will cause the church to understand that as people are being enriched in everything, the blessing that God promised Abraham by covenant becomes the portion of the believers in the church. Thanksgiving goes up to God, not complaint, not murmuring, not condemnation, not judgment. Thanksgiving. I want you to know something, please. When God speaks a word to you, write it down. Write it down. Because if you don't write it down, you don't understand when He begins to work. Some people think, well, God doesn't speak. Who told you He doesn't speak? He speaks every day to everyone. The problem is people are too proud to listen. Or they're too proud to write down what He said. They don't want to listen to what He's speaking and communicating. If you're ready to listen, He's ready to speak. Remember what Samuel had to say first. Before the Lord would speak to him. Speak, Lord, for your servant heareth. And I want you to note this down, please. 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and the portion of scripture about seed sowing is a portion of scripture that talks about finances. I heard a very educated man from famous theological institution one time stand and say, well, it's not talking about money. How can you call money seed? Well, look at 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Paul called it seed. And if Paul called it seed, remember the anointing on Paul called it seed. Because the Bible tells me that there was nothing recorded in the Bible that the Holy Ghost was not involved in. Everything was recorded as the Holy Ghost moved on people and spoke to them, and they recorded it for us. So it's not the mind of Paul. Theologians always are confused because they think it's the mind of Paul, or it's the mind of Peter, or it's the peculiar mindset of Timothy. No. No. It is the mind of the Spirit. Can I have an amen, please? It's the mind of the Spirit. Don't fool yourself by getting into a lot of theological junk that doesn't help you one bit in your practical everyday living. Remember, God is in your routine. Every day, if you cannot see God,
in what you do,
then I'll tell you something. You have no personal relationship with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Because he's a God who's connected with his people on an everyday, every moment basis. God is in your routine. Come with me to Philippians chapter 4, please. We're going to read from verse 14, Philippians chapter 4, verse 14. The King James Version of the Bible records it like this for us. Notwithstanding, you have well done that you did communicate with my affliction. The Living Bible writes it like this. But even so, you have done right in helping me in my present difficulty. What was the difficulty that Paul experienced? Lack of proper support. But then someone came and started supporting the ministry of Paul. Who were they? Paul is writing by the unction of the Spirit, and he said, what you did was right. Well done, according to the authorized version. Now you Philippians know also in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church communicated with me as concerning giving and receiving, but you only. I want you to mark that phrase. No church communicated with me as concerning, not prayer, giving and receiving. That means you can have misers in the church who are waiting for a miracle to happen that never happens. Do you know why? Because they have not learned the key to success is to sow seed. The Philippian church was not a rich church. But the Philippian church was a church that understood the principle of giving and receiving. Seed time, harvest. It's not I gave and I don't have. It's not I gave and see my lack. Some make God look like a miserable miser by the way they testify about how they gave and never received back. Remember, even in the way you give, you got to understand it is giving, receiving. Seed time, harvest. It's wrong for you to say, I gave and I forgot about it. I'm again repeating. For years, religion taught us, you give, don't expect anything back. So what happened was, religion taught it to people who never put the Bible first. So they grabbed what religion taught them. They would read this portion of scripture and say, no, it's not talking about money. It's not talking about finances. It's not talking about anything material. It's talking about spiritual things. Now please listen. Because they gave and never expected to receive back, when the miracle started happening, the devil robbed. And because people were not expecting, the devil took. People didn't even know what was rightfully theirs. For years they thought if you lost something, you lost it. Finished. Over. The Bible doesn't tell us that. I don't hear people this morning. How many of you believe what I'm saying? The Bible doesn't tell us that. The Bible tells us when you give, you receive back. That's what Paul taught. Whether it was to the Corinthian church or the Philippian church. You must understand the principle was the same. Seed multiplied, harvest. Giving, receiving. So the Philippians rose up to the challenge. They knew that Paul was in a difficult scenario. They knew that Paul had a need. What did they do? For even in Thessalonica, you sent once and again unto my necessity. Mark that down, please. Some people think that the pastor lives on love and fresh air. He doesn't have a care in the world, no needs. It's only the church that has needs. The church needs fans, the church needs lights, not the pastor. And I'm talking about people, may not be the mentality of people in this church, but I'm talking about people all over the world who have that kind of mentality. They don't understand that preachers have needs too. Can I have an amen, please? I don't hear people here. Paul said he had a necessity. There were things that had to be done. He said, my necessity. He did not say the church's need. In the book of Corinthians chapter 9 in 2 Corinthians, it was different. It was the body of Christ's need. Here Paul said it was my need. Can I have an amen, please? I want you to write it down. Some of you shake your head here. But sometimes you don't understand this in real life scenarios. So Philippians chapter 4 verse 16 is so different from 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Paul there was talking about the body of Christ's needs. There was a need. And there was this church that rose up to handle the need. Now Paul is giving commendation to the Philippian church. Look at verse 17. Not because I desire a gift, but I desire fruit that may abound to your account. Now that's the principle all over again. Whether you're giving to the church or whether you're giving to the individual who's serving the Lord in ministry, your seed is converted into fruit. He said, I'm writing this not because you must think or misread or misunderstand. That means this was the same misunderstanding that people had then that we have today. The preacher is out to get my money. Now the preacher is not out to get your money. The preacher wants to see you blessed. He wants to see you have fruit in your account. Isn't that amazing? Partnership with God creates an account. Just write it down. Partnership with God, His work, and His anointed creates an account where fruit is deposited. I'm going to repeat it all over again. Partnership with God, His work, His church, His kingdom increase, as well as with His anointed. And remember, when we talk about the anointed of God, it's not a gender issue. Creates an account where fruit is deposited. For every seed you sow, in fact, some of you are here because of the seed someone sowed on your behalf. There are your people this morning. Look at verse 18. But I have all and abound. I am full. Is Paul being proud? No. He's being gracious enough to acknowledge his necessity has now turned into abounding fullness. Write it down. Abounding fullness. That means there's no lack now. There is abundance. Fullness. I have all. Brother Hagen served the Lord faithfully for so many years, spoke about the mentality in certain churches that he had pastored. He said some people were so miserly when it came to giving that they had a mentality which was something like this: God, you keep the preacher humble and we'll keep him poor. You keep the preacher humble, we'll keep him poor. Look at what Paul was saying. I have all. Not I have little. I have in abundance. Now I don't need to do something like tent making. Do I hear an amen from this church, please? People are slowly opening up to what Paul was saying. Remember, Paul was a tent maker by profession. He said, now I don't need tent making. My needs are being met. But if my needs are not being met, I'll go back and be a tent maker. I will not penalize the church because of my call. I'll go work. So what do you have with a working preacher? You don't have a man who can give his everything to you at all times. And that's the condition with most churches all over the world. And it's terrible. I'm not just talking about here in India. I'm talking about all over the world. So you have pastors who are going and working and trying to be a pastor. Why? Because somehow the church board doesn't believe that they should have all. But the Bible says you can have all. And the church board is not the one to decide whether you'll have it all or not. Can I have an amen, please? With due respect to any board, the board doesn't respect God's word, then they are not a board at all that can receive any form of support from God. Follow this carefully. I have received of Epaphroditus the things which were sent from you. So we're not talking about spiritual things. We're talking about material things. Just write that down, please. Because I have heard people in Bible college in certain places stand and say, this giving and receiving is all connected with spiritual gifts, not with material things. The things which were sent from you. An odor of a sweet smell. A sacrifice acceptable, well pleasing to God. I'm going to go over this very, very slowly. He said, whatever I received, gave forth an odor, a smell. Ever seen someone come from abroad and open their boxes? I mean, the smell that lingers in the box, for some reason or other, seems to linger for quite some time. And you'll have people, when no one is looking, even lifting the pen and smelling it and saying, beautiful smell. Now Paul was saying something that I want you to catch in your spirit. Remember what I told you about Noah's giving. When Noah in the book of Genesis gave his best, the clean, after the flood was over, God smelled something. It was a sacrifice acceptable, well pleasing to God. And God blessed Noah with what? Productivity, enhanced fruitfulness in this earth. That's you. That's you. When you give, you don't lose. You receive enhanced productivity. I don't know whether you listened to the testimony that our brother gave a little earlier. Some of you may not be understanding exactly what he's talking. He was a man who did not handle business of the company. Now he is moved into a place where business deals are being struck in his presence. And they are not for millions of rupees. They are for millions of dollars. In fact, this week he'll be traveling again to Switzerland. You listen to what the Joseph's anointing will do. You'll see it work. Wise men still seek Jesus. Someone who was counting bags of cement and getting a few hundred rupees for a month is now moved in over 8 years' time to a place where he is dealing with millions of dollars. You talk about whether God really promotes. My friend, promotion doesn't come from South India. Promotion doesn't come from the east or the west of India. Promotion comes from the north where God resides. From the place where God resides. The sides of the north. God is the one who lifts a man up. Some people never understand giving and receiving. They never understand seed time and harvest. They never understand the principle behind what God asks you to do. God is not mocked. When he speaks, he knows what he's talking about. Now come back to verse 18, please. An odor of a sweet smell. Is Paul talking about a natural odor being emitted from the things he received? No. Because he is connecting it to God. Can I have an amen, please? He is saying something is happening when you give. Your giving, please listen and write this down. Your giving is now being converted from material things into something else. A sacrifice on the very altar of God. And it's an acceptable sacrifice. That means your giving creates the atmosphere for a miracle to happen. Few amens. I can prove it to you over and over again. Your giving creates an atmosphere for miracles to happen, because your very giving makes a miracle happen. Material things are converted into sacrifice on the altar, acceptable, well pleasing to God. It's only after that we come to verse 19. Most people quote verse 19 but have never learned the earlier verses one bit. How often, as a pastor for so many years in the ministry, I've heard people glibly quote verse 19, but my God shall supply all my need. My friends, they're wasting their time if they have not learned to practice what Paul was talking about in the earlier verses. Simply wasting their time. Remember what I wrote in the newsletter. I said a disobedient man who's a non-tither will have to learn obedience. There will be no use, no matter how many men of God lay their hands on him and pray. What he needs to do is obey God's word. Because the key to blessing is not rebellion, it is obedience. Willingness and obedience, you'll eat the fruit of the land. Two things in Isaiah chapter 1, willingness, obedience. Willingness, obedience. Willingness, that means your will must be connected to your obedient act. Some are giving in resentment. Every time they give, they think, well, 10% of my income is going. They don't understand that the tenth that they have of the gross is God's money. I don't hear people this morning, it's God's money. When you're faithful with God's money, the millions will begin to come into your hands. What we see in this church is not the majority of people who received inherited wealth standing up to testify. We are talking about people who are receiving wealth come their way on the basis of God's word at work in their life. That's a testimony. Thank God for inherited wealth. But remember, there are people who are standing on God's word, who are receiving wealth that they can give as an inheritance someday to their children and children's children. Can I have an amen, please? It's amazing how God begins to partner with you in your giving. A sacrifice acceptable, well-pleasing to God. If you want to be a person who's pleasing God, then please him not just with your words, with your acts of sowing, giving, seed time. Now look at verse 19. But my God shall supply all your need. Now, till now, Paul was talking about his need. His need was supplied by God through the Philippian church. Now he is talking about a divine connection. A divine connection. I don't know whether you remember what we taught on January 1st, 2007. If you don't, get the CD and listen to that message all over again. You need guidance. Then sow a seed. Do you know Balaam did it and received guidance from God? Some people say, I don't know what to do. Well, if you don't know what to do, sow a seed. Sow a seed. Now, the man who had come in the other day, who I told you had come from UK, did that. He was talking about so many things that he was encountering in the UK. He was talking about different needs that he had. But there was something he did that day. He grabbed my hand and put something into my hand. Seed. He said, thank you for the newsletters. Thank you for the CDs I received. I want to sow seed. On the way back, guidance. I mean, can you understand that guidance can be that accurate? God will tell you who to meet. God will show you what to do. God will release favor on your behalf. All as a result of your seed. Listen, but my God shall supply all your need. The word all your need does not imply because they gave to Paul, now they have a need. It implies that they already had needs. They had needs in different areas, but they were ready to put their needs behind them and handle the man of God's needs. Handle the one who was ministering to God, his needs. Now Paul is saying, as you have done that, God will now become a divine supplier of all your needs. There are people who have always said, well, these people who teach on giving and receiving seed time and harvest make it look like God is some big supplier. My friends, he is a supplier of all supplies. And you better put a big S to the word supplier. He shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory, according to the riches of his weightiness of presence by the anointed one, the Messiah, Christ Jesus. What gave Paul that assurance? He had the assurance in his heart because he saw it happen in his life. And he knew God was no respecter of persons. He had a need, God supplied his need. Now he is looking at the Philippian church and saying, all your need, God will supply. According to who? Not the economy of your land. Write that down, please. Not the economy of your land. The economy of your land will not dictate God's supply chain. According to his poverty. Is that how your Bible reads? No. According to his riches. So it's not a sin for you to look at someone straight in the eye and say, my God is a rich God. And I don't know about what you say or what you believe, but I know my God is a rich God. You have to pay your way through life. You need money to handle your need. Well, be of good cheer because God will provide. How will He do it? Not by pouring down money from heaven. Some people always make things look so spiritual that you don't understand what they're doing or saying. It looks like God poured down money, brand new notes from heaven. He doesn't pour down brand new notes from heaven, my friends. Please. God is not a counterfeiter of notes. Money is the means of transaction here on earth. The means of transaction in the kingdom of God is God's word about sowing and reaping, giving and receiving, seed time and harvest. That's the currency in heaven. And in the kingdom of God. No wonder you can't buy a blessing from God. But you can receive a blessing from God if you sow seed. There is a difference. People have always attacked preachers, ministries, anointed people with the wrong accusation. They say, how can you buy a miracle? You're a fool if you thought you can buy a miracle. I said, you're a fool if you thought you can buy a miracle. You can buy medicines from a pharmacy. You can never buy health. You can pay your doctor's bills. But there's no full assurance in your heart that because of that you will be cured. You can never buy a miracle from God. One man in the book of Acts tried to do it. Simon the sorcerer. He saw how the apostles laid hands on people and they received the Holy Ghost. And he thought, he was sincere, he thought he could buy that gift for money. But you can be sincerely wrong, my friends, when you think you can buy something from God. So he approached the apostles. And he said, I'll give you money. Just give me that power. Do you know what Peter said? In fact, it is from that one incident that you have that English coinage of the word. Simonary. Come into being. That is trying to buy something for money. Peter looked at him and said, your money perish with you. Can I have an amen, please? And that will be the portion of every man, woman, and child included. Whoever thinks that they can buy something from God for money. You can never buy anything from God for money. But if you live according to the principles of seed time and harvest, you will see the blessing come your way. But if you need money, finances, like Dr. T.L. Osborne, one of the men of God who have been anointed to reach people in our generation, taught in one of his books. If you need money, and you must understand the importance of money, then God will give you more than enough to handle your needs as well as to sow out. Again, I'm repeating, to sow out, to give out. That in the process, there will be a perennial blessing of a return harvest that will come your way. If you gave to men, then someday men will give back to you. But the glory will be God's. The praise will be God's. Thankfulness and thanksgiving will be addressed to God by you and by the beneficiaries of what you gave out. So I want to show you an example of that. You want an example? I want to show you an example. Because if I don't show you an example, you're not going to fully be convinced about what I'm talking about. You mean to say, Pastor, that I will have my fees for this particular course that I'm going to attempt? Well, if God's in it, you will have the money. I'm again repeating, if God's in it, you will have the money. But if you want a perennial return to come your way, learn to be a giver first. Sow seed. Don't say, I don't have now. How can I sow? Sow with what you have. Little is much when God's hand is on the little. The 5 loaves and the 2 fish fed 5,000. Why do you think it's going to disappear when you give it into the hands of God? I want to show you an example. I can show you many examples, but I want to show you a very clear example. Let me put it like this. Whether it's for paying fees, whether you need something that you want to buy. Some of you have carried a dream seed in your heart for quite some time. God will give you the ability to buy it. Financial ability to buy it. And you'll be a wise person if you'll just say an amen. He will give you the financial ability to buy it. I'm again repeating, lest you didn't hear me right. He will give you the financial ability to buy what you desire. Let me show you this example, please. Come with me to Deuteronomy chapter 2. And I'd like you to share this example with people. So write down Deuteronomy chapter 2, please. Because unless you have scripture with you, you can't talk to anybody. You don't have anything to talk to anybody, really. No one wants your explanations. No one wants your ideas. No one wants your opinions. Because opinions don't change the tide in people's lives. God's word does. The entrance of God's word brings life and light. Deuteronomy chapter 2, please. Now this is Moses preaching to the children of Israel. Then we returned and took our journey into the wilderness by the way of the Red Sea, as the Lord spake unto me. And we compassed Mount Seir many days. And the Lord spake unto me, saying, you have compassed this mountain long enough, turn you northward. Enough of abiding in one place. Enough of parking yourself around a mountain. Be ready to move northward towards the blessing. I want you to see that God never wants his children to always park themselves in one place spiritually. With every level of opposition that you encounter and overcome, you must understand the blessing is enhanced. The lion and the bear may have been enough for David to look his dad Jesse in the eye and say, all in order, Dad. But when he had to encounter Goliath, the blessing that came was people started singing and worshiping God in dance and then repeating a refrain. Saul had killed his thousands, David his 10,000s. An ordinary man, never known before, never even considered much by his own brethren, was catapulted into national prominence. Write that down. Enough of being around this mountain. God was saying, time to move. And command thou the people, saying, you are to pass through the coast of your brethren, the children of Esau, which dwell in Seir. So who was dwelling in Seir? The children of Esau. These were the children of Jacob. Cousins. You want to call them country cousins? But cousins nevertheless. Now listen, this is God speaking to Jacob and his descendants. And they shall be afraid of you. Take ye good heed unto yourselves, therefore. Meddle not with them. Mark that down. Why? Remember the promise that Jacob received by deceit and ran away. He received it from Isaac deceitfully and took off. Then the Bible says Esau came in. And Esau started weeping. And then Isaac started prophesying. He said, you live by the sword. And when you're served long enough, you'll break his yoke from off your neck. Can I have an amen, please? What was Isaac saying? He was sowing seed for Esau's descendants to be blessed as well. It may not have been the covenant blessing that was the patriarchal blessing, but it was an earthly seed that was being sown. Now harvest was being reaped. What was the harvest? God was telling Jacob's descendants, hey, listen. Modern day language, listen, they are going to be frightened of you. Don't mess with them. Don't become cocky. Don't think because God is with me, you can walk in arrogance and do something against them. Meddle not with them. For I will not give you of their land. No, not so much as a foot breadth. Because I have given Mount Seir unto Esau for a possession. A good man leaves an inheritance to his children. Isaac had blessed Esau. God said, I'll back that blessing. I will not even give you a foot breadth. Can you believe that? Even if one fellow said, let me just put my foot in. God said, be careful. You got to take it out. Or you lose your foot in the wrong place. I will not give you even a foot breadth in this land. I have already given it to the descendants of Esau for a possession. Now, this is the most important thing. You shall buy meat. I mean, this is something that can knock people off their seats. God is telling his people, pay as you go. I have provided for you. Well, Lord, what did I do for you in Egypt? I asked you to go and demand your backlog of wages. Get it back. Now, make use of it. Buy meat. Some people think if you get everything free, it's God. Wrong. Wrong. In fact, the best way to know if God's into something is if you'll have the money to buy it. Pray, seek his face, and then get the money to buy it. I heard David Duplessis one time, was going to be with the Lord, preach. He was talking about so many things in that message. And he was talking about the anointing that came upon him when Brother Smith Wigglesworth laid his hands on him and prayed. But then he also made mention of something. He said, I always pay for my tickets when I travel. He said, I never expect someone to pay my tickets for me. Because that way I know whether God is in my travel or not. Pay as you go. Buy meat. Buy meat for what? For Thanksgiving? I'm again repeating. Is it buy meat for saying hallelujah? Immediately they say that means 2 kgs. Mutton. 3 hallelujahs. Talking about 6 fish. Please get this right. Don't fool yourself. While you live on this earth, you need money. But the thing that you need to understand is whether it's the money that has come into your hands the right way or the wrong way. And then when it has come in the right way, how you honor God with your finances matters. Buy meat of them for money. Money. That you may eat. That means when you go into a hotel, be ready to put the money on the table. Don't be expecting if I say hallelujah, maybe they'll let me off. There are people who are living like that. You may not have met them. I've met them. They're that super spiritual. I mean, they're crazy. They're what you would call people who are filled with charismania rather than charisma. They're maniacs. I met one such person one time in Bible college. What's your name? What's the name of your father? The lady is filling it out. What's the name of your father? God the Father. What's your address? Heaven. I said, this is not the place for you. Get out of Bible college. This is not the place for you. This Bible college needs people who can identify who their parents are on earth. You can guess they were dressed in white and white. Name of your father? God the Father. Address? Heaven. So when I talk something, I know what I'm talking. I can't exaggerate from the pulpit. If I exaggerate from the pulpit, I have to pay for that. It's a terrible price for exaggeration. You've got to keep the facts right. Buy meat for money off them. A transaction has to happen. Business transaction. So if you think God doesn't know business, please think again. Do you know some people think that you can't be a good Christian and do business? They're actually foolish. They don't know God understands business more than they even know what business is all about. And you shall also buy water for them. Bisleri you need. Don't go and hit a rock on the road saying it'll come from there. You better have the money to buy. What we are really looking at, it sounds humorous. It's not really the humor part. It is God understands everyday living well. He was not talking to a bunch of backslidden people. He was talking to covenant people. People in covenant with him. He was talking to kingdom children. Maybe they were Old Testament kingdom children, but they were kingdom children nevertheless. In fact, every blessing we have as Gentiles in God's kingdom today comes as a result of the blessing that these people had and enjoyed as a foundation. And that's why Paul went one step further in his writings. He said, you are just wild olives grafted in to the original olive. So don't be high-minded. Walk with the fear of God in your heart. Don't despise the Jews. I said, don't despise the Jews. You may not like the way they look. You may not like the way they talk. You may not like the way they act. You may not like the way they dress. But don't fight them. Don't fight them. Start loving them. And if you read the papers, I think it was the day before, yesterday, you will see how the Jews are learning Tamil, Malayalam, and one more regional language. They are learning it. Indian languages. That means God is bringing a divine connection. Remember the 1,44,000 Jewish evangelists in the book of Revelation who will be someday supernaturally raised, who will go all over the world and preach the gospel? I can believe it. I said, I can believe it. There will be Jewish evangelists who will come and speak fluent Malayalam, fluent Tamil. It is not a distant reality. It is already started. And only a fool will think that it is a language issue. It is not a language issue. It is a prophecy already coming to pass. You need meat? Buy it. You need water? Buy it. Again the repetition. You shall buy water for money that you may drink. Don't say, our father Isaac went and dug a well, I'll dig a well in Mount Seir. He said, no. You need money. You need water? Buy it. Now this is important. For the Lord thy God had blessed thee in all the works of thy hand. When the blessing in all the works of your hand comes, money is part of the blessing. I'm again repeating, money is part of the blessing. Get ready for an increase. You. He knoweth thy walking through this great wilderness. That means God knows the way you walk through the land. He knows the way you walk through the land. These 40 years, the Lord thy God had been with you, with thee. Thou hast lacked nothing. That means lack is not a kingdom blessing. I don't know whether you're listening to me carefully. If you'll just write down what I'm saying. Lack is not a kingdom blessing. Now, God was just trying to tell these people, listen, just because you didn't lack anything for 40 years, don't assume when you enter into Mount Seir, people will immediately recognize your kingdom children and start doling out things to you. You will have to be mature enough to put your hand in the pocket and put money on the table and buy. So part of your maturing process is the ability you receive to handle money. Just keep writing. I'm talking by the anointing. Already a prophetic word has gone out to one individual here that an increase is on the way financially. If you will just grab a hold of it, you will know what I'm talking about. So the ability to handle money is part of the maturing process. Some people say, well, I don't know how to handle money. You better learn how to handle money. We're going to stop with that for now. But how many of you believe it was good to be here this morning?